Good evening. We welcome you tonight. How many of you, your hair got wet? How many of you had to chamois off your head? Yeah, there you go. Amen. You know, sometimes it pays not to have hair. Both of my hairs got wet coming over from the office. It was tragic. But we are glad you're with us here in sunny Florida. And I'm not going to murmur and complain after that guy preached last Sunday. We're going to accept it. Go on boldly. Is that right? Good. 503 in your hymnal. 503, singing I go a long life's road. 503. Let's all stand together as we sing The Trusting Heart to Jesus Claims.
The trusting heart to Jesus clings, nor any ill forebode. But at the cross of Calvary sings, praise God for lifted loads. Singing I go along life's road, praising the Lord, praising the Lord. Singing I go along life's road, for Jesus has lifted my load. The passing days bring many cares, fear not, I hear him sing. And when my fears are turned to prayers, the burdens slip away. Singing I go along life's road, praising the Lord, praising the Lord. Singing I go along life's road, for Jesus has lifted my load.
So the question is, as you go singing down this road, praising the Lord, what are you praising him for? Salvation. Amen. That's number one, isn't it? Good. What else?
Good health.
Good health. Amen.
Prayers.
Prayers? Okay. Answered prayers too. Your wife. Amen. That's got to be worth at least 20 points right there. I tell you what. Back rub for sure. Amen. God meets all of our needs. Amen. What else?
Safety.
Safety. Amen. How many of you are thankful for the Lord for healing over the last couple months? Amen. Yes, indeed. You're a bunch of sick people, I tell you what. What else? What else are you thankful for?
His church.
Amen. Good. Amen. 25 points for that young man. That's right. We're moving up now. Somebody give him 10. Rusty, give him $10. Amen. Good. Well, you know, we're a blessed people. We're a blessed people. When you get discouraged, just stop. Don't write down all the bad things. They're already in your head. Just stop and think how good God has been to you. Think about what you deserve. And as a Christian, what you're going to get. Wow. We have a lot to be thankful for, don't we? Let's sing that last together. When to the throne of grace I flee,
when to the throne of grace I flee, I find the promise true. The mighty arms upholding me will bear my burden too. Singing I go along life's road, praising the Lord, praising the Lord. Singing I go along life's road, for Jesus has lifted my load.
Amen. Well, we appreciate you being here. You made it through the rain, and you survived, and thank you for being faithful to the house of God. You know, for some Christians, any little excuse will do to keep from going to church. And I appreciate you folks just saying, you know what, we're going. And you're here, and you're faithful, and we thank you for that. Pray that God would speak to you tonight and bless you for your faithfulness. And Brother King is preaching for us tonight, and looking forward to that, and to hear what he has to say. I've spent some time with him today, and it's just been a real joy to have you with us already. And we'll talk about the offering, if we're going to take one or not. And we'll... Let me give you some prayer requests. This is from June, her neighbor, John Headland, in the hospital with COVID, very, very sick. And she's asked him to pray for that. His name is John, if you can remember that. And then I visited Pete today. Pete is over at the hospice place in wherever that is. It's the Joanna Hospice toward Naples. Okay, I'm still new here. I'm not quite sure where I am half the time. Struggling with medication and pain, and just really pray for Pete and Bonnie at this time. Sue Walling, pastor's sister. Sharon Dietz, these with cancer. Bill Craver, Ken Erdman, who's making progress. Carol Lee, continue to pray for her. And then pray for Pastor Strange. He is in Fort Lauderdale preaching tonight. Then he'll be flying out tomorrow to go to Puerto Rico. And so be praying for him. He'll be with Johnny Daniels for 11 days preaching and serving. And it's great to have Miss Judy back with us. She's been laying out of church. And no, not really. They've been. Can I do this publicly? Pastor, this has never been announced, so this is the first time and the last time. When Pastor decided to step down as pastor, he told me that he wanted to stay away from the church for a year. Now, that wasn't me, that was him. And he did not want to be any kind of a hindrance to a transition. He said, I don't want you to make an announcement or say something, and everybody look at me like, what do you think about that? And I really appreciate that. Now, since that time, I've actually asked him to come back, and he said, no, not yet. But I just want you to know what's going on. We don't communicate real well sometimes. But so Pastor and Miss Judy have been visiting churches, and they're planning at some point, I think, to go out west. And Pastor said when the weather cleared, and I thought, well, Pastor, that's probably June, you know. But it is great to have Miss Judy back with us tonight. Also, I want to pray for Brother Jim Wendorf. That God would continue to strengthen him and he could have his knee replacement here in the future, and Larry Lautner having surgery on his eye here in a few days. So let's pray. Yes, ma'am.
I talked with Alex Stanley.
Yes, thank you.
She is in rehab.
Yes.
And a
yes, thank you. I tried to see her yesterday, but they're not allowing any visitors in. But do pray for Alice Stanley, and she's on the list here. She is, and I just thought of another one when you started talking to me. What was it, June? I can't remember either. Maybe it'll come back. Lord, oh, I know what it was. It was about Bill Stout. I called Bill Stout yesterday. I said, how you doing? He said, great. I said, where are you? He said, Minnesota. So he's doing really well. And got to go see his kids for a couple weeks and doing well. Hello, Joan. Welcome back. I am. Yes, ma'am. I have it written right here because that's why I forget. I'll do that during the announcements. Good. But thank you for the reminder. Good. You know me well. That's good. Lord, we do thank you for the healing touch that we've seen on our congregation and many folks who've been sick, have been raised up. And Lord, we thank you for that. And Lord, we do pray for these special needs tonight. Think of June's neighbor, John, very sick in the hospital. Don't know if he's a believer or not. But Lord, if he's not, boy, he needs to be raised up and come back to health before it's too late. And I pray you do a work in his life. And Lord, that you would also be with Alice there in rehab, help her leg to heal, and for her to be able to get back up and around quickly. And we continue to pray for Pete and help them as they try to get these medications straightened out for him, for Sue and for Sharon dealing with cancer, for Carol Lee with severe back trouble, and also for Ken as he continues to recover from sickness. And then we do pray for Pastor as he's traveling to Puerto Rico. Pray you give him strength, keep him safe, and Lord, use him in a special way as he ministers. And just watch over Miss Judy now as he's away from us, and just bless her during these days and meet her needs. And for Brother Jim, Lord, continue to work in his life, and Larry, as they have upcoming surgery, and we pray that you would help that to be successful and just touch these men and work in their lives. And Lord, we thank you for allowing us to come together tonight and ask you just to speak to us through the Word of God. Pray for Brother King that you would just have your hand upon him, give him great freedom tonight, and may you direct him about what to preach and what to say, what not to say. And Lord, may you change us. God, speak to our hearts tonight, we pray. Bless over in the King's kids and the youth and the young adults, and all these meetings going on in the grounds. Lord, bless this time, we pray. May you be exalted in everything we ask. In Jesus' name, amen. While you're standing, wave to someone nearby. Make people feel right at home. There you go. Good. Wonderful. Outstanding in your field. Good. Thank you. All right, good. You may be seated. We have made a change with our offerings, and I really wanted, and Doug mentioned this to me, and I did not follow up on it, but if Doug's out there in the lobby listening, I like your plan of go ahead and putting the plates up here in front in case somebody wants to give beforehand, and I know you haven't had that opportunity today, so today is just a normal offering. Come on, men, and we'll receive the offering tonight. Now, we're going to be taking two offerings tonight, so let me give you a heads up. This is our normal Wednesday night offering. We are taking a special mission offering for the Whitakers in Pocatello, Idaho. Remind you of that. Be praying about that, what God would have you do. That runs through next Sunday. And then at the end of the service, as you're going out, we're going to have ushers to frisk you, take any money that's left, and we'll give it to our speaker, and he's excited about that. He's going to preach hard tonight. Now we'll take a love offering as you leave tonight for Brother King, and so just want to give you a heads up about that. I guess since we're back doing this, one of you guys needs to pray. Andy, it's been a long time since you came here and prayed. We'll let you pray first.
Dear Lord, Heavenly Father, it is grateful to be in that house tonight, Lord. We thank you for your many blessings, Lord. And thank you, Father, for giving us such a great day today, Lord. And I pray, Father, that you bless this time, Lord. Bless the service tonight. Bless the speaker, O Lord. Give him high power from on high to preach, O Lord. And Father, touch those that are sick and not be able to be with us, Lord. I pray that you lift them up and so they can soon be in that house, O Lord. And now, Father, we ask that you take this offering and bless it, so they can be used to further thy gospel, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Is one of the great attributes of God. If God was not faithful, where would we be? You couldn't believe his word. Wouldn't that be terrible? We have anybody visiting for the first time tonight at Winkler Road Baptist Church? Anyone visiting? We've got folks. Yo, great, wonderful. Tell me your names.
This is my wife, Kay, and I'm Arden. We're from Wisconsin. I'm a retired farmer, and I know that Bob Fowler invited me, so you got to hear this, farmer.
Good. Okay. Well, we're glad to have you with us tonight. Good. One of the men is running to get something so you can register. And I you probably have a church home. That's fine. But there is a gift if you turn in the visitor's card. It's well worth your time. And so Brother Doug will give that to you there. And we're certain. Oh, you've already got one. Somebody's really on the ball. That's impressive. Yeah, I don't think so, Doug. I know better. Remind you again about the special offering for the Whitakers. If you were not here Sunday, that's just a two-week offering. And these folks are church planters in Pocatello, Idaho, and they have the opportunity to buy an old Lutheran church and then convert it over to a Baptist church. I put a baptistry in and some other things. But the down payment's $150,000. Last time I talked to them, they had $130,000, and I'd like our church to do as much as we can, our own home, to help buy this church. And that's impressive to me, to be reminded about that. Also, this coming Sunday night, we want to get a vision of what God can do and would like to do at Winker Road in 2021. And what God has laid in my heart, and give you a theme for the year. It'll take my goals and multiply them many times. But when you have goals, then you say, okay, how are we going to reach the goals? If you don't have any goals, my dad used to say, he who shoots at nothing always hits his mark. There's a great truth to that. And I think often in the church, we're kind of guilty of shooting at nothing. And we want to have goals, and we want to know how to get there and what to do. So that will be this Sunday night. Hope you'll make your plans to be with us. And then it's good to have Joan back with us. And we are having a memorial service here at the church Tuesday at 2 o'clock for Brother Miles. Tuesday, this coming Tuesday at 2 o'clock. Okay? So wanted you to know about that. There won't be a receiving of friends per se. We'll just have the service at 2. And so wanted you folks to know. And of course, I'll announce that, put it in the bulletin also Sunday. Good. Let's take your hymnal one more time. 577, a song we've kind of been teaching you, has a great message. 577, be strong in the Lord. We'll remain seated as we sing on that first stanza.
Be strong in the Lord and be of good courage. Your mighty defender is always the same. Mount up with wings as the eagle's ascending. Victory is sure when you call on his name. Be strong, be strong, be strong in the Lord, and be of good courage, for he is your guide. Be strong, be strong, be strong in the Lord, and rejoice, for the victory is yours.
And the last,
be strong in the Lord and be of good courage. Your mighty commander will vanquish the foe. Fear not the battle, for the victory is always his. He will protect you wherever you go. Be strong, be strong, be strong in the Lord, and be of good courage, for he is your guide. Be strong, be strong, be strong in the Lord, and rejoice, for the victory is yours.
Well, I've mentioned a couple of times, our guest speaker tonight is a man that I've known for several days. If you were here Sunday night, you understand that. He showed up in the service. I said, who are you? He said, I'm your speaker Wednesday night. I said, oh, well, my long-lost friend. And Brother King will tell you more about himself when he comes up, but pastored for many years up north. And really, God has opened up a wonderful ministry to him in missions. And sat down with him today and just talked about what their church is doing and the different mission organizations in the church. And his position is the mission pastor or missionary, I'm not sure, mission pastor? Pastor of missions, I'm not sure. And just exciting things and looking forward to got to sit down and eat and just listen for a while, and a man of great wisdom, and I know he'll be of great help to you tonight. So after I sing, he will come and open the word for us tonight.
Once a man whom we know as the Son of God hung upon a cruel tree. He suffered pain no mortal man could do. He took my place, he did it all for me. He did it all for me. Each drop of blood he shed for even me. When the Savior cried, bowed his head and died. Oh, praise the Lord, he did it all. When I step just inside of the gates of pearl, and the Master's face I see, I'll gladly kneel at his nail-scarred feet. Oh, praise the Lord, he did it all for me. He did it all for me. Each drop of blood he shed for even me. When the Savior cried, bowed his head and died. Oh, praise the Lord, he did it all for me. He did it all for me. Each drop of blood he shed for even me. When the Savior cried, bowed his head and died. Oh, praise his name, he did it all.
Turn your Bibles to Matthew chapter 20. I feel at home here. I've been here several times, and I love Pastor and Mrs. Strange. What a joy to see him at the pastor's meeting. But I've come to really know and love your young pastor, and that's Pastor Seaman. That's great. It's glad that God has worked things well here, and I tease a lot. I laugh about a lot of things, but I never make fun of the things of God. I don't tease about the Bible or about souls or eternity, but I see humor in a lot of things, and I'm a happy, happy clam. I was preaching in a church, and my wife was traveling with me on that trip not long ago, and wow, I just have a good time. But this woman, Wednesday night, Thursday night, Friday night, she sat in the pew and she just glared at me. She never cracked a smile. I think if she'd have smiled, her face would have cracked. I mean, she was weaned on a pickle or something. And I don't know, for all I know, her husband died. I don't know. But every service, she just glared at me. She never cracked a smile. She never anything. She never spoke to me. She never shook my hand. Sunday morning, Sunday night, on the way out on Sunday night, she walked right past me, but walked up to my wife and shook her hand, and she said, "I just have one question." Lori said, "What is that?" She says, What kind of sin were you in that God cursed you with that the rest of your life? Well, my wife just busted out laughing. She said, oh, I was in deep sin. I was backslid bad. Well, can I tell you, she brings it up about once a month. You know, Randy, if I wouldn't have been in bad sin, I wouldn't have had to put up with the likes of you the rest of my life. But I bring you greetings from her. She wishes she could be here. She loves this church as well. She's flying in on Friday. And tonight I'm going to excuse myself a little early. I have a son flying into the airport down here at 8:30, so I'm going to kind of bug out. But I want to mention the book table. When I pastored, I allowed our people to ask questions, to write them down, and then I did my best in the adult class to answer them from the Bible. And these are the lesson sheets from those lessons. I had never intended to sell them or make them available. They're just for our local church. But each of them is a result of questions that our people asked. If you look on the one side of the table, there are thicker books. Those are $20. The thinner ones are $15. I don't get a dime from the books. I just pay to print them, and then I give them to pastors and missionaries and charge you a little more than it costs us to print. I can't make any money on them because I'm an avid researcher, and I quoted and stole stuff from everybody I could. Now, if you steal from another person, that's plagiarism. But if you steal from 20 people, that's research. Now, it's legal to do that if you're just teaching a lesson, but it's not if you're going to sell it and make money. And so all of it's from the King James Bible. All the blanks are just in the Bible verses so that you don't need an answer key or a teacher's manual. A lot of people use them as soul-winning tools. They'll say, Brother King, I was witnessing to this person, and they said, well, hey, what about afterlife experiences when I had a near-death and I saw God and he was orange and furry? Or, hey, Pastor King, what about the charismatics? They say you can lose your salvation. Or, Pastor King, doesn't a sincere Buddhist go to heaven because he's just doing the best he knows? And I'm saying, sincere questions deserve a sincere answer. And so I would do my very best to answer those questions from the scriptures. If everything's predestined, why does God need our prayers? And, you know, why don't we fellowship with churches of other denominations? Here's one. If a Christian uses a credit card, is he helping the Antichrist? Okay, if a sincere person asks a question, I don't care if they're pauper or prince, they deserve a sincere answer. And I did my best from the Word of God. And so I just want to encourage you to get them. There's a blue envelope there. Put the money in there. If you want to make change out of there. If you want to steal a book. Baptists are the world's best bookkeepers. They've kept a bunch of mine. And so, you know, I mean, I want the material to be out there. If it can help you, that's great. And so thank you for letting me be here. One of the things that's so important to me, I'm for the pastor. I'm for the church. I am our church's missions pastor. I was saved at 18. I live still on our dairy farm in Wisconsin, just near Oshkosh. Some people are familiar with where that is. And our family farm's been in our family since 1847. And I still live there. And my twin brother, he got all the looks and all the girls. I got squat. But I have a twin brother, and we still have our farm. But I got saved at 18, and God called me into the ministry. And while I live at home and got to raise my children on the farm, well, I no longer milk cows, but I'm happy to serve churches. 42 years at Wildwood Baptist Church, and now 8 years traveling as the missions pastor. And So for me, I want to say Brother Don Strange is a dear friend to me, and I'm honored that he'd let me come, and I'm thankful to be back here. And of course, one of our friends from Wisconsin was Brother Rusty Ross and his wife Hong, and I know him and his children, and I delight to see him again today. But the story of the farmer who went to church for the first time and he heard the pastor mention tithe, and he said to him afterwards, tithe, I never heard of that word. What is that word? And the pastor says, you know, it's a tenth of everything you have. It was an Old Testament principle that's carried through the scriptures, and the first fruits belong to God. He says, a tenth of all you have. He said, Henry, if you had 1,000 hogs, why, 100 of them would belong to God. And he says, yeah, I see, that makes sense. He said, or if you had 100 hogs, why, 10 of them would belong to God. And he said, Pastor, I see that. He said, or if you had 10 hogs, and he says, you hold it right there, preacher. You know I got 10 hogs. You can preach anything you want unless you actually expect me to do something. And I pastored for 42 years. What I'm challenging you with tonight in the brief moments we have, I'm asking you to do something, and I make no apologies for it. You have a flesh that says, do less. You have a world that says, do nothing for God. You have a devil that says, don't serve the Lord. But you come to a place like this, in a pulpit here, in a pastor like this, and he's saying, let's do more for God Almighty. You know what? You're going to get to heaven and you're going to say, thank God there was a voice in my life that said, let's do more for Jesus Christ. You'll have no regrets when we stand before the Lord. So, Matthew 28, 19 and 20, very familiar passage. I'll let you stay seated, but I'd like you to follow along and read verse 19 aloud with me. I'll read verse 18, 19, and 20, but you join me on 19. Here it says, and Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Together, go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Lord, we want you to come to church tonight. Would you use the sword of the Spirit, the Word of God, and speak to each of our hearts? Thank you, Lord, for these faithful souls, many of them serving you for decades. But Lord, we need your help, and we want to be pleasing in your sight every day from here till when we see you. Help us with that. Help Winkler Road Baptist Church and their exciting future. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Every church that I'm acquainted with that's a fundamental Baptist church will say, hey, our goal, our purpose, our existence, we're here to bring glory to God Almighty. We were created for His pleasure, Revelation 4. We were created for His glory in Isaiah. And we're here to glorify God. And then the purpose statement will have the Great Commission in Matthew 28, 19 and 20. It'll say, and what we believe we're here pleasing God in our worship and in our families and in our fellowship, but we're reaching lost souls. And we find this, our marching orders in the Great Commission of go, teach, baptize, and teach. Hey, get them under the sound of the gospel, get them saved, get them wet, and then teach them all the things in the Bible and get them busy serving the Lord. And so we have this as our marching orders. And we don't, you know, I don't like it when people are duplicitous or they have ulterior motives, or you always wonder, what are they really thinking, or what are they getting at, or what are they trying to get out of me? I don't like it when people are like that. But when somebody plainly says, hey, I'm trying to get you to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, to be conformed to the image of Christ, to serve him and to reach lost souls, and I make no apologies for it. That's what we're trying to do here and around the world. And I know that's not news. I'm not trying to have news. But think of it from a pastor's perspective. Just for a moment, my goal, my marching orders, my orders are win 'em, wet 'em, and work 'em. Right? Every pastor knows this is true. Hey, if I can get them from being a brand new Christian, growing the milk of the word, the bread, the meat of the word, if I can present them faultless before the Lord, if I can have them grow in grace, if I can help them increase their faith, if I can present them faultless before the throne, if I can have them perfecting holiness in the fear of God, I'm trying to get them from wherever I find them to where they ought to be. Now, when I got saved, I was 18 years old. I was in college for mechanical engineering, and I had a bunch of friends. I got saved in December, January, I'm going to get baptized. And I invite my college friends, hey, would you come watch me get baptized? And they go, no, we don't go to a Baptist church. Well, I tell you what, if you come and watch me get baptized, we'll go to the tavern afterwards and celebrate Randy getting baptized. Now, three of my friends said, sure, we'll go hoist a few. And so I come on Wednesday night before my baptism, pray for my friend Tom and my friend, and hey, they're coming, and afterwards we're going to go out and celebrate at the tavern, and if you want to join us, you can come. Now, the miracle of it is the pastor kept a straight face. But I'm saying to you, be patient with a new convert. They don't know what they don't know what they don't know. And while there's this decision, I've got somebody and they're saved and they got all the warts and wiggles and trappings of the world. Jesus raised Lazarus, but he said to those around him, loose him and let him free. We have a job in helping get the grave closed. God does what he can do. But we have a role to play, don't we? We help them and help them grow. Now, the question becomes, do I have to wait till they get perfect before they can serve the Lord, or do I want to start using them the way they are? I crossed that bridge real early. In John 15, here is my Father glorified that ye bear much fruit. Every branch in me that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now, I'm born and raised on a farm. We have an orchard. I get pruning the branches. The tree's growing. It's got these sucker branches. They take the energy. They take the nutrients. They take the moisture, but they don't produce any apples. And so I cut the sucker branches off at a time when it won't hurt them. I get rid of that which is just encumbering them so it can bring forth more fruit. That's the Bible principle. Hey, they're bearing fruit, then God does the Holy Spirit office work in the heart, and he purges them that they may bring forth more fruit. My job as a pastor is, hey, I want them to be involved. Why? Because people go from being a spectator to being a participator. It goes from being, that church does this and that church does that, to our church does this. We feed the poor. We have a bus ministry. We help little kids. When they take ownership in the church, when they say, this is our church, this is what we do. And so, hey, sure, I got a guy, he still smokes. Well, as a pastor, I'm probably not going to have him maybe greet people at the door with tobacco breath. But he might be able to come on Friday night at the youth activity and be the bathroom door policeman. and you stand by the boys' bathroom door, and if three or four of those hoodlums start tearing up the bathroom, open up and say, boys, get out of there. It doesn't take a spiritual giant to do that. But if I can get him bearing some fruit, God can begin to purge him, that he brings forth more fruit. We have annual events. We have the men's steak and shoot. We go out on a farm. We have skeet shooting and cowboy shooting. And we have guns and T-bone steaks and no women. But I don't care. What I had a dope head that was coming to church. And I said, hey, could you somehow line up a truck and trailer and load some of the chairs and take them out to the men's steak and shoot? You understand what I'm saying? Hey, get them busy. Get them engaged. Get them involved. Give them ownership. Hey, can you grill the T-bone steaks? Hey, we have an aviation ministry. When the plane's about to leave, could you go and give sub sandwiches to the guys going on the trip? Hey, the plane is back. Can you go and wipe the oil out from under the engine cowling? Hey, could you take the bus and gas it up on Thursday? Hey, could you be the one who furnishes refreshments for the nursery or resupplies the diapers? I'm saying, when you pastor, you eat, drink, and sleep this. You say, how can I get these people involved? I want to get them from wherever I found them to where they ought to be. You say, well, Brother King, are you saying you had sinners in your church? Yes, professional ones. The only guy that thinks he has a perfect church is the one that doesn't know his congregation. In our pews, I've had prostitutes, homosexuals, bank robbers, and murderers sitting in front of me. And that was just the deacons. If I didn't believe the grace of God could get a hold of a heart and change somebody, he's able to save to the uttermost all who come unto God by him. You got to get past any Pharisaism. I'm not saying accept where they are. I'm saying help them get out of the grave clothes of this old world. But only God can do the pruning in the heart. If they're just conforming to some rule you make, that's not really Holy Spirit conviction. Now, there's an imaginary line in front of every pew in the front row of every church. There's this imaginary line. And the more people you can get to cross that line, the healthier your church is. Now, it's a little bit of a euphemism, but hear me carefully. When you get people who go from watching to participating, I don't care if it's singing in the choir, playing the organ, giving their testimony, song leading, praying for the offering, responding at an altar call, reading a poem, having part in the Christmas program, somehow they go from watching to participating. The more you can get people to cross that line, the healthier your church is. It might be teaching a class. It might be in some other form of service. Maybe it's a junior church or whatever. But every pastor, he just, hey, I got to get them saved. Got to get them baptized. And now teach them the Word of God. And somehow find a place of a service to get them engaged. Now, there's a secret to all of this. The Bible says, those that are in Christ, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water, right? That's the idea, is you're a Christian, and that ought to manifest itself. It ought to out itself in some fashion, some form, some way, some place. Turn your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 5, and if it helps you find it. It's somewhere closer to the maps. 246 in my Bible, if the page number helps. And it's talking about the Lord Jesus Christ. And I love to preach of the love of Christ and all of that, but today there's a very practical thing I'm pointing toward, and I so want you to see this book, chapter, and verse. It's talking about Christ, and verse 8, though he were a son, yet learned he obedience by the things which he suffered, and being made perfect, he became the author of eternal salvation unto all them that obey him, and called of God and high priest after the order of Melchizedek, of whom we have many things to say and hard to be uttered, seeing that ye are dull of hearing. Now, can I just get right to this? I believe Paul's writing this. I believe it's to the Hebrew Christians and all of this, and the typology of Christ after the priest of the order of Melchizedek and him learning obedience. Lots of things that we could talk about here. But sometimes when an epistle is written, it's a letter of commendation, and sometimes there's some admonition or a condemnation. You earn the right to say hard things to people. When, you know, you can't just walk up to somebody and say, your mother wear army boots and you're ugly, dumb, fat, and stupid. Because when you just do that, they just back up. You earn the right to say hard things to people. You walk up and put your arm around them, and then you can slap them with the other hand. If they know you care about them and you honestly are trying to help them, you can say hard things to somebody. But if they think you just have an agenda different than that, they won't listen. The Apostle Paul spends time the first few chapters, hey, God loves you, what a blessing. But did you notice at the end of this verse 11, he says, seeing ye are dull of hearing. I would say the next verse or two might be a little bit of a rebuke. And we got to take that along with the promises, don't we? And so watch what he says. For when for the time ye ought to be teachers, ye have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles of the oracles of God, and are become such as have need of milk, and not of strong meat. For everyone that useth milk is unskillful in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. But strong meat belongeth to them that are of full age, even those who by reason of use have their senses. Watch how it says, reason of use have their senses exercised thereby to discern both good and evil. The words use and exercise. Now, so the idea, just briefly comprehended, you start out and we give you the milk of the word, right? Acts 15, the new Gentile Christians will lay no other burden on them to abstain from things strangled and from blood and from things sacrificed to idols and from fornication. For Moses is preached in every city, and we're not going to tell them they have to keep the law of Moses or observe the Sabbath days or be circumcised. We're just going to tell them the basics, the new Christians. But lots of Bible got written after Acts 15, folks. And it's a shame to have long hair, or don't go to law with your brother, or observe communion, or there's lots of Bible after just the basics, isn't there? And when the Bible says he's called pastor, he's the evangelist for the perfecting of the saints, we're trying to get them from where we start to where they ought to be. And so the milk of the word, it's the Bible, it's the Holy Spirit that does the work. And the guy that led me to Christ, Pastor Nelson, he had a saying. He says, I don't mind putting the bottle in your mouth, but I'm not going to part your whiskers to do it. What he's saying is there comes a time when you ought to be doing something yourself. Here, he says, hey, you're dull of hearing. For the time you ought to be teachers, you have need that one teach you again. And you've become as such that need milk instead of meat. And he says, Milk belongs to babies. Meat is for those that are full age, who by reason of use have their senses exercised thereby. These things began Jesus to do and teach. If you're really going to be pleasing the Lord, you're going to be serving him in some fashion. And I like the phraseology, you ought to be teachers. I know it's kind of embarrassing to think of it this way, in that it's a narrow focus, but if I said everybody that gets saved, my ultimate goal for them is to be a teacher. A teacher. Teaching and admonishing one another in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. When you sing the Lord's praises, you're teaching. When you're teaching a Sunday school class, when you're giving your testimony, we'd take a bus of teenagers and go to a family's house and have the father of the house give his personal testimony to the teenagers. Hey, teaching, personal one-on-one discipleship, giving your personal testimony, opening the Word of God and try to lead someone to Christ, finding a way to take all that you've learned and put it into practice in teaching someone. You ought to be teachers. That's the, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. So we get this all working good. We got a church, hey, we got them saved and baptized, and now we got them teaching, and we got them involved and serving and growing, and how wonderful is this? We got people going to the rest home and singing and preaching, and we got people going and ministering in the jail ministry, and we got nursery, and we got choir, and we got Sunday school classes, and we got junior church, and we got guys leading a little orchestra, and we got, hey, this is so wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. And then March of 2020 comes, and COVID-19 comes, and all the guys who preached against TV evangelists, now we are one. Hey, everybody! Get off the playing field. Get up in the stands. You can watch me preach. No, you're not going to teach. No, you're not going to sing. No, you're not going to the rest home. No, we don't have a jail ministry. No, we're not knocking doors. No, we're not bringing them in on the van. No, nope, 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 nope. You're watching me. Hey! Live stream. Are you kidding me? Look at this. Our missionaries from across the globe are watching us. A couple of our people that are in the military are watching us. Even some of our disgruntled church members are watching us. This is wonderful. We have a church of 200 and we got 800 hits on our website. Hey, there's online giving. Press the button in the lower right corner and you can give money. And the pastors discovered, our people have the attention span of a gnat. I'm only going to preach 20-minute sermons. And the offerings are staying pretty good. Maybe the Methodists got it right. You can just have one service a week and a short sermonette and you still get paid. I didn't say that. Strike that. But after a few weeks, every pastor starts to struggle with, I don't care if Dr. Fauci invented the virus. I don't care if it was the Democrats or... Here's what I know. Our church isn't what it ought to be operating like this. Well, okay. And listen, my wife had COVID and nearly died. I had COVID in July. I've never been that sick in my life. I wouldn't wish it on anybody but a couple people in Washington. Maybe a lot of people in Washington, but it's real. It's not funny if you have a loved one who dies. But the church, for the health of the body. The pastor's saying, hey, we've got to get back to what? We've got to get our people out of the stands. Back in the battle. On the front lines. Now hear me. What does he do? Well, let's see. We can't do this, that, we can't do this. Well, we have one new ministry. We've got a guy running the camera now. Hey, we got another guy. He archives all of our old sermons and puts them on the website. I mean, that's a job. We got a guy who comes in between services and sanitizes the back of the pews. There's a job. What's missing? What's missing? Anything resembling reaching lost souls for Christ. Teaching the Bible. Singing God's praises. Serving others in the ministry like the food ministry. Hey, listen to me. We've got to get back to doing what we know is right to do. Every pastor I know, I've been out of 52 weeks last year, I preached 51 of those weeks. The meetings held for me. But every pastor on Saturday and Monday, Brother King, they won't. We try knocking doors and the people just curse us off the street. They won't let their kids come on the van or on the bus. Brother King, we're developing a lesson series on Acts chapter 2. The Hebrews 10, forsake not the assembling yourselves together. They're assembled for prayer and the ministry of the word and bearing one another's burdens. And hey, Pastor King, our people have got to get back to. Why? Why does a pastor think like that? Because before this, he had a well-oiled machine in getting people saved, baptized, and busy. Win them, wed them, work them. And now, those that ought to be teachers, in some cases, they need to start over. I can't tell you. Sure, in every church, there's a couple deacons who will still deke. And the treasurer usually comes and the old stalwarts will be there. But what about those who were just growing, just coming along, just maturing in Christ? Many of them have been washed overboard as casualties to all of this. I'm not being funny. I'm saying to you folks, this is serious business. You ought to be teachers. The time comes that you ought to be teachers. And so the pastors are struggling and flailing and plotting and planning and praying and struggling. How can I get our people back busy doing the work of the ministry? So, you know, the government said don't. Well, we're still going to assemble. The government said, well, we're still going to. Why? The pastor doesn't want to be a lawbreaker. He doesn't want to appear that he's not conscious of what's going on, or that he doesn't care about your grandmother dying. They're struggling with, sorry. They're struggling with, how can I get people back involved and still be considered prudent and reasonable and loving and kind? How can I, as pastor, provide the leadership, the inspiration, and the opportunities for to get our people back busy, actively serving? Listen, This is, Christianity has never been a spectator sport. This has never been about just watch 10% of the people do 90% of the work. That is not Christianity. It's everybody in whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplieth according to the effectual working in the measure of every part maketh increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love. You bring your gifts, your ability, your talents, your resources to the body. And you employ them and engage them and practice them to benefit the whole church, to reach lost souls. And I'm just challenging you, hey, you might have got in a bad habit of just sitting back and watching and see what's happening, or what's the pastor going to do next. And wow, can I just challenge you, as we forge into 2021, you find your place serving. Out of your belly should flow rivers of living water. When the time comes, you ought to be teachers. That's what it says. And I'm challenging you, hear me carefully, please, would you get the mind of God for you? I don't have this deputy Holy Spirit badge. Frank should be doing this. I don't know. But I know this. If you with a pure heart will say, Lord, show me what I can honestly, uprightly, prudently, godly do. God would show you. He would open a door. A man's gift maketh room for him, the Bible says. And he'll show you what you can do. Get the pastor's guidance. Follow his leadership. Do your very best to coalesce together. I've learned this. A pulling mule can't kick. And a kicking mule can't pull. Right? What happens if people stand around doing nothing for a while? Do you think they find things to start complaining about? The health of the church, the future of the church, not just for the sake of souls, not just for the glory of God, but for your personal walk with the Lord. Would you ask him, Lord, show me what I could honestly and uprightly do with the talents and opportunities you give me to benefit this body of Christ? And then would you pray and ask the Lord, guide our pastor to have unusual discernment in how to lead our flock in these trying times. Could you pray a prayer like that just between you and God and mean it with all your heart? Heads bowed and eyes closed tonight. Heavenly Father, thank you for these dear folks, and I know they've been under a great, great ministry and heard wonderful, wonderful preaching, but these are very unusual times. Would you help the church not to lose its focus? Help us not to be deviated from our purpose. Lord, help us to make sure we're going after souls. And then, Lord, helping them to be baptized and grow in grace and on to spiritual maturity. But Lord, would you use us as your tools, your instruments, your vessels fit for the master's use to accomplish your work? And I do pray for Pastor Seaman. Lord, what a wonderful man of God. Protect him, undergird him, strengthen him, lead him. And Lord, we're going to need your help for all of this. And so we ask you to sweep in and be the hero and do that which only you can do. We need your help for that. And we pray and ask for it in the mighty name and through the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Pastor.
Mm-hmm. Well, your heads are bowed, your eyes are closed. Let me encourage you to respond. God has spoken to your heart in a specific way. The ladies are going to play. And you come on as God has spoken to you. Thank you. You may look this way. Brother King has, as he mentioned, slipped out. He's on his way to the airport to pick up his son tonight. So, but his books are on the table and the envelopes are there. What did he say? Remember, anybody remember the prices? You guys are good. All right, 20 and 15, and the envelopes are there. And we are going to have a couple men, a couple of ushers stand at the door. And all of this offering that goes in the plates at this point will go to Brother King. He'll be coming back tomorrow. He's actually staying in the area for a while, and he'll be back tomorrow to get the rest of the books and things, and we'll pass that on to him. For those that are watching live stream tonight, you're probably wondering what in the world's going on because the camera never moved, and he was everywhere. We don't have a cameraman. See, he talked about how great the cameraman was. We don't have one. And so things were kind of on autopilot. So if you're wondering at home why you saw him half the time, that's the reason. Of course, it didn't affect you folks here, but just wanted to explain that to them. And thank you so much for being faithful tonight. Great crowd. Appreciate you being here. And we will see, Lord willing, Sunday morning at 10. And let's be in place, and let's be serving the Lord. We have restocked the tracks, lots of tracks as you go out the door. Make sure you grab a handful and pass them out this week. And let's try to reach folks for Christ. Thank you so much for being here. You are dismissed.